First of all, I would have liked it to be more. I've said that publicly on TV. But the RBI has also added to this kitty by coming out with, within Basel III, new set of capital adequacy norms, which gives another additional breather to banks of 35,000 crores for this year. So, total amount is 60,000 crores. My personal view is that there is more to go and there is more to be, which will be required, and which is why I believe sooner or later, the government will be between what a challenging situation, which you call as between a rock and a hard place, okay, where do you hold 51% of the government ownership, which means you have to put in more and more capital to sustain that 51, or do you let the public sector banks be widely held and let them raise money from the markets and drop below 51. The government in the budget has also announced in that context that they are looking at the option of testing it with IDBI banks, where they will be ready to explore government ownership to go below 49%. The tougher question is, and this is back to the society debate, is our political system and the social system ready to see a dilution of government ownership below 50% in state-owned banks? And you will have, we will have to address this question, if not this year, I think more focus, in a more focused manner in the next 3 to 5 years. And also keep in mind that in addition to the challenge on the asset side, each of us banks are also running breathlessly to be at the cutting edge of digital. And we have to be really ahead of the curve if we want any of your accounts, okay? If we are not there, we will not get you, okay? And in that context, whether you are a government bank or a private bank, each of you will demand the quality of service at your fingertip in the future or even now. So, to what extent is our banking system ready to face that challenge of extreme competitiveness in the digital world, and at the same time, the pressures of capital for asset challenges on the asset side? And the digital world, friends, we all know, is pretty brutal. And one of the realities of the digital world is, in most cases, the winner takes all. Okay? If it's a Google, there may not be any room for a Yahoo. If there is a Apple, you ask the question, what happened to Nokia? If there is a Facebook, you ask the question, what may happen to Google? Correct? And if there is an Amazon or a Flipkart, can both win? Or as a Snapdeal, with all win? So, you are moving in a world where the whole competitive landscape of digital on the one side, huge needs of talent on the other, and an asset challenge on the other side. And in that context, I live on the edge of paranoia. Every day at night when I go to sleep, I ask the question, will I have a bank next morning? Or will there be an Ali bank or a Google bank which will have finished me? So, can you imagine the kind of change we are going for? And are we ready for that? On one hand, and Mr. Maligam is aware of this, the RBI is opening up competition in banking. It's given 21 new licenses. And there is talk to add another. So, we may see 50 banks, which new banks, which we have not seen in the history of Indian banking. And the fact of the matter is, never in India till date has the system allowed a bank to fail. It has got it merged. Now, when you open banking for 50 new banks, therefore you are saying, I am opening up barriers to entry. Anybody can enter more easily. One of the things which society will have to answer, and I think both policymakers will also have to evaluate, that free entry also means freer exit. And inevitability of free entry is death on the other side, because few will win, many will lose. So, how ready is our system from a societal point of view for mortality with your savings. So these are the debates. Competition is great, technology is open, everybody is free. But is how do you feel if tomorrow you are not comfortable with your money in the bank? And these are the questions which we will have to answer. And what is the model we want? Do we want a complete protection of the state, that no, my money should be guaranteed by the state come what may? Or we want better service and therefore freedom, but with the risks? And those are the trade-offs we need to think about very closely as policymakers and society.
Thank you.
Good evening, sir. My name is Sagar Vyas. I'm a student of V-School. So, sir, I had a question that the current budget, it revolved a lot around Make in India, particularly around the infrastructure market. So, sir, with low demand in the market, with the commodities market primarily falling in globally, should the government have made for India rather than Make in India? And is Indian is India moving towards the next China? Is that happening? Do you think is that what's happening?
Okay, let me answer the second question first, and I'll take the first question along with it. China. Let me share a fact with you. You know, when we Indians, all of us have to be careful, okay? In the period 2011 to 2013, in 3 years, China produced more cement in 3 years than what United States of America produced in the entire 20th century. This is a factual statement, huh? And if you want to check it, it's on Bill Gates' Twitter. In 3 years, China produced more cement in China than what United States of America, the world's largest economy, produced from 1901 to 2000. Okay? The scale at which China now is mind-blowing. I'll give you another statistic. Why do you think suddenly you have said this protection in steel? China's steel capacity is 900 million tons. China's steel demand is 600 million tons. Surplus, 300 million tons. India's steel capacity, 110 million tons. Demand, 85 million tons. And China was exporting its surplus capacity to India. It could supply India fully. So we have to be careful when we compare on a relative scale where we are versus China. Therefore, apna Bollywood movie is still pretty small. Okay? It is needs to get into the mega theaters. Okay? So that is the challenge vis-a-vis China. And on Make in India, the big debate is are we a little late in the manufacturing cycle, or is there still opportunity? And have we sort of, because China was ahead in the game for a long time, is it now tougher for us to make up? And here there is a very significant change which is happening, which is Make in India and the whole digital revolution is creating a new kind of a make. Okay? So it is services, manufacturing, packaging, technology all coming together. Therefore, the concept of Make in India is unlikely to be the kind of Make in China which we have seen. It will have to be our unique mix of what we call as Make in India and make our unique mark of creating a package and a bundle of products which are different from the traditional manufacturing. And I would love, therefore, a Foxconn and others who are coming, I think that is a good news. I think certainly it's better late than never, and I think we will have to do the Make in India game. But as a person from services industry, I will add to this way. Make in India, and even more importantly, serve in India. Okay?
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir. I'm Vidhan Khanna and I'm from Wellington Institute. So you talked about the importance of US in your speech. So Donald Trump in his campaign speeches has been talking about getting back the jobs from India and China in particular. So how do you think it will impact the Indian economy and the job market?
See, by now you should know that when a politician is speaking for winning an election, is different from what the politician does after winning the election. Okay? So Donald Trump is in the same position right now where he's working towards winning an election. Okay? So I would not necessarily assume that his behavior will be exactly the same. But the counter is also true. There is a global challenge for jobs. And every country politically needs to create more jobs. And if you are wanting to win in a democracy for that national interest, there is a clamor for getting jobs. At the same time, you are having a situation where, thanks to the technology evolution, you are in that interim phase where the speed at which new jobs are happening is slower than the speed at which old jobs are going away. We hopefully see a situation where this will balance and ultimately get better. But right now, from a political rhetoric point of view, it is very powerful. Long ago, Thomas Friedman wrote a book on the world is flat. And there was a line there where a father was having dinner with his daughter and son, okay, over dinner. And like typical kids, they were leaving most of the food on the table. And this is what the father told them. Okay? Just as you are not caring about the food, remember one thing. There is somebody out there in India who is hungry for your job. And be careful. Eat this food or you will lose your job. Okay? So that is the kind of development you are seeing in the world. And there is a challenge to jobs in certainly in the US, but we are having the same problem in this country. India needs 12 million new jobs a year. And we are creating far fewer jobs. And I think one of the reasons why the focus of this government on Make in India is a very clear understanding that to win elections, you need to create jobs. And whether it's America, whether it's India, whether it's anywhere in the world, the single most important agenda for the world today is how do you create jobs? And if you can't create jobs, you snatch them from others. That's what is happening.
Thank you.
Good evening, sir. My question is pertaining to Kotak Mahindra's acquisition with ING Vysya. It was very successful, and it was basically successful on two counts, wherein it expanded its footprint and improved its CASA ratio. So my main question is, do you see or foresee any other bank undertaking the inorganic route of development in the coming future?
You know, there's a very famous saying, na? All that glitters is not gold. So, yes, the logic of the merger is absolutely right. But I can share with you that making the merger work is taking my sweat and toil and our entire firm's sweat and toil. And at this point of time, we are in the middle of really getting the cultural issues, the technology issues, everything together. And it's a lot of pain and hard work which we are right now going through. And therefore, at this stage, we are not even thinking about anything else. We're just wanting to make sure we make this merger work for all our stakeholders. And that is our number one priority. And should we think about something in the future, we will certainly let you know.
My name is Dhruv Saharia. I'm from Narsimhanji. So my question is, you've spoken about the expansion of the banking sector and also of, you know, the merger. How do your talent acquisition policies change in terms of, you know, retaining key talent and also, you know, encouraging the spirit of innovation in times like these, especially when the industry is changing and there's a lot of competition out there?
You know, the biggest question for banks and financial institutions is, our weakness, And our weakness is if you're successful. The problem for any institution is success, because success leads to complacency. And that's one thing we really worry about. Therefore, how do you create an institution which has had success and therefore is an easy sitting target for any player in the future? And I keep on giving the example, and I'll tell you what we are doing in a minute. I keep on giving the example of Amazon versus Barnes & Noble's 2000. Barnes & Noble was sitting pretty as a bookstore dominating the world, okay? And here is an online player coming in, wiping out Barnes & Noble in front of everybody. And therefore, the biggest disadvantage for an institution is legacy. And at our place, we are working very hard that we create a mindset which is ready to challenge existing legacy. We are also, for example, in our digital world, we have created in our office, a whole separate office which looks like a startup. That's not good enough. You want, the purpose of creating an office which looks like a startup is you want to create a mindset of a startup. And the challenge in an existing set, well-settled firm is how do you create a startup mindset in a complacently successful world? And in this whole race for the digital, we are using three words. That in many areas, we are growing our business on the principle of user, usage, and think about monetization also only after that. It's the classic WhatsApp model. What has Facebook done with WhatsApp? It has created huge number of customers. I'm sure most of us must be on WhatsApp. But do you know there's no revenue model? And Facebook has said, we are in no hurry to create a revenue model. We want to get more and more users. We want these users to do more and more usage. And monetization, we will do it sometime. We are not in a hurry. And that's what exactly they did with Facebook. Therefore, for us as a bank, our problem is, we are too much revenue driven. We always think, you know, because a lot of our managers are management students, no? So they make 5-year business plans, revenue model year 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and they have to show profit at the end of 4 or 5 years. While the new world is saying, forget profit, I just want to own customers. I'll figure out how to make money later. And this is the challenge which we are facing. Therefore, how much bets do we take without a revenue model? So if you can give me a good guidance and a model about how much of our money we should throw without having a revenue model, and how much should we keep for a revenue model, and how markets would react, that would be a great project paper I would appreciate from the management school.
A very good evening, sir. This is Tejas Shukla from Willinker. As per recent report from McKinsey, it is said we are going towards bankless future. What is your view on this?
My view on this is something which actually Jamie Dimon has given an interview also. So, and my view on this is the need for bank-like services will always be there. Okay, therefore, you always need somebody to take care of somebody's savings and somebody needing money. So, go back to the first principles. How did banks start? Somebody had surplus, somebody needed money. So, a banker stood in the middle and intermediated, and in the bargain made a little bit of money. Secondly, somebody had a need to send money somewhere else. So, you needed ability to transact. Okay, so that need will remain, but the models will change. And I believe that, call it banking, call it financial intermediation. Don't get obsessed with the word bank. Think about financial services intermediation. The business of financial services will remain, and it will be in three parts. First will be transactions. Transactions is where there will be the biggest attack on margins. Banks work on pretty fat margins, okay? I'm giving you a secret, okay? So if for example, whether it is money movements, foreign exchange, trade, everything. Banks are used to having charges, service charges, this, that, and the other. Okay? Those margins will be under threat. So, the cost of transactions, as I see it, will become cheaper and transactions will become better and faster. So, banks either compete and let their margins go down and grow, or run the risk of getting out of that business. But banks have the ability to compete from where they are. Okay? That is on the transactions. So, transactions will be significantly at lower margins for banks than ever before. Second is risk management. Risk management, again, two parts. At the very retail end, it will be commoditized because it will be based on models. But at slightly higher end, it will be about judgment, about taking calls based on analysis, but finally an art of risk, managing risk. That function will always remain as an important intermediation function. And you can see it in today's times also. There are banks and banks. Some banks are doing better job, some banks are not doing such a great job on managing risk. Therefore, managing risk will be a very significant intermediation function in banking. On the model-based risk, keep in mind, life has taught us again and again that for a while models are right, but sooner or later there's a black swan and models turn wrong. Okay? So therefore, don't take models for granted forever. So the risk management function will always remain as a key function in financial intermediation. Call it by whatever name, maybe call banking or any or googling or whatever it is, but there will be an intermediation function. And third one is knowledge and skill. The intermediation function around knowledge and skill will always have a role. Let me give you the example of asset management. Each of you as savers can put money into a fund with a discretionary asset manager or into an ETF, which is dump money into the index. But even today, larger part of the industry is into discretionary asset management. Therefore, there will always be people who want to do commoditized asset management, and there will be people who want knowledge and skill. Therefore, there will be role for analysis, insight, and I understand Mr. Mankekar is also teaching here. He is one of the most outstanding examples of ability to pick on knowledge and skill the winning companies of the future. So, we will always have this thing about knowledge and skill. Similarly, investment banking, structuring. Mr. Maligam has a great reputation, for example, in valuation on mergers and acquisitions. And he's done many of them in his career. It is out of knowledge and skill. Therefore, financial intermediation in area of knowledge and skill will always stay. But transactions will remain in the financial space, but will be significantly at lower margins. Risk management, knowledge and skill will be the core to financial intermediation.
Hi, sir. This is Milan from NMMS. My question is that the RBI is given a lot of credit for its prudent policies and execution of the same, and is also credited with saving the economy on several times. So, nowadays, the government wants to have a greater say in the monetary policy decisions as well. So, being a private banker, what is your take on it?
I think there is a complete unity in view between the RBI and the government towards transparency. Therefore, and I think the RBI has also made it clear that if there is excessive dependence in terms of policy making on one individual, from a system point of view, if you look at the next 10 or 20 years, it may not be the right model. Therefore, you need a concept of a monetary policy committee, but the independence of the monetary policy committee is extremely important. That decision making is not taken for political reasons, but on the basis of what makes sound monetary policy. I think the foundation of that is put in place by one of the mandates to monetary policy committee is inflation at 4 plus minus 2 as the range within which the monetary policy of India needs to operate in. And then once you have that process, you combine it with an institutional framework which is free and independent. You have a more robust, transparent process on monetary policy rather than excessive dependence on the judgment of only one individual. And I think from a long-term point of view, and something I will share with you, you know, an important in a different context is, you know, that how do you balance between individuals and institutions? even in the role of entrepreneurship. An individual is a, very often is the founder of building of institutions. But over time, institutions are more important than any individual. And this for a fundamental framework is taking us in a direction where you have an institutional framework for our policy. And I strongly commend that approach.
Good evening, sir. This is Akash from NMIMS.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. So my question is regarding private corporate investment in India. Sir, given the weak state of banks, is a creditless recovery possible in India?
I think the Indian economy is still at an early stage. Therefore, there is enough demand for credit. The question is quality of credit, amount of equity backing the promoters. In fact, the problem is reverse. Problem is need for adequate capital for a lot of businesses in India, which at times tend to be undercapitalized. And the banking system in India was doing a little bit of a role which was not supposed to be its role of what you call as venture or private equity in the form of loans. And you're now coming to a situation where those risks of that lending have hit the banking industry. Therefore, you need more capital, but based on that, there will be a need for credit because we are still in very early stage of cycle of our development. I am really delighted today as the global commodity cycle is negative, as global capacity and Indian capacity is so large. This is the time to build India, to build India's infrastructure. And we have a broken model today because of what is happening to many of the promoters in the current system. But this is the time to make India and build India's infrastructure. There's one area which I think is as powerful as any startup is professional entrepreneurs with a small equity stake backed by institutional investment, building India's infrastructure. It's the single most important opportunity on entire planet Earth.
Good evening, sir. My name is Kalpesh Rathod and I am from V School. So my question to you is, historically, CASA accounts have provided 4% interest rate. Could you please explain the rationale behind Kotak Mahindra Bank providing 6% whereas everybody else is providing 4% on CASA accounts?
My logic is simple, okay? And look at it the reverse way. A term deposit today is 8%, okay? It used to be 8.5%, 9%. Even today it is 8%. Now we provide 6% above 1 lakh and 5% below 1 lakh. Our weighted and on NRI is a little low. So our weighted average cost of money is 5.5%. If I get your money at 5.5%, I'm still saving versus 8. And I'm acquiring more customers. On the other hand, if you look at the growth of savings account balances of most banks, banking industry average is at about 15%. We are growing our savings account balances at 40% per annum for the last 5 years. So we are getting higher growth. We are therefore, and it is a viable business for us. Yes, there's a higher cost, but I am in the business of acquiring customers. We just heard about the challenges of Facebook's, Amazon's, 21 new banks. At that point of time, why should I let or give opportunity to newcomers or existing banks, but I must grab more and more customers for my bank. And that's exactly what I'm doing. And welcome, open the account at 6% with us. Thank you very much.
Sir, cool, sir, make extra effort to make our students ready for the industry. Therefore, what would Kotak Bank expect from MBAs?
Yes. Okay. I would, you know, let me first say that though I am an MBA, for a long time, I was enamored by the chartered accountant profession. Okay. And I will tell you why. If I am a part of your fraternity, okay. One of the things I really would like to see as a combination in any young professional is ability to think big picture, which is what an MBA does better than chartered accountants, but also a readiness to go into detail. Okay? And the key combination for success, friends, is your ability to manage big picture and detail at the same time. Okay? And my recommendation to you is, there is a perception about the MBA managers that they don't like to dirty their hands enough. At times, they like to become subs. In the startup world, there is no role for subs or mem subs. Okay? Be ready to roll up your sleeves, dirty your hands. No job is too low for you just because you are an MBA. Okay? And MBA has given you a mindset and a discipline and a training. But thereafter, it is a competitive open world where you will be judged by what you do, how you think, and how you execute. And MBA is not a passport for sustained growth. The passport for sustained growth is you, yourself, your mindset, your ability to be doing the right things, proper conduct, values, and a huge passion and desire to succeed. That's what you should be doing.
Thank you, Sir Kotak. I think you gave a brilliant lecture, but an even more brilliant responses to the questions which have been raised. As you said, I have been on the board of the Reserve Bank for some time, and therefore I cannot resist the temptation to offer my few comments on some of the matters which you raised. You mentioned about the credit crisis, and I entirely agree with you that the reaction to the credit crisis, the stimulus which was given by the international banks, had plus the advantage, of course, of immediately containing the damage, but also the long-term effects of that. In fact, at the Reserve Bank, we did, even at that stage, anticipate the difficulties which would be felt. But why is it that in India we escaped this credit crisis? And I think one of the reasons why we escaped this was, or two reasons. The first was the high regulation which we had. There was a feeling earlier that the Indian banking system is over-regulated. But I think it was the regulation itself which helped us in the crisis. And I'll give you an example. The major reason for the crisis was the property boom in the US. But insofar as India was concerned, at least 2 years before the crisis took place, we realized that a boom was developing in the real estate market. And therefore, what the Reserve Bank did was, first, it said the provisioning which you make against standard assets in real estate should be higher than it was there. And second, that the exposure limits on real estate should be reduced. So I think that was one of the factors which helped us in meeting this crisis. Now, you raised a second issue, which was about monetary policy. Now, monetary policy is a very complex matter. And I think sometimes people don't really understand the problems which are faced by a monetary policy authority. We call this the impossible trinity. Because what is the impossible trinity? In monetary policy, we have to look at inflation, we have to look at growth, and we have to look at the exchange rates. Now, if you want to control or contain inflation, to some extent, you have to give up on growth. And if you want to have growth, then you must be prepared also to consider the implication of growth in terms of getting in a large amount of foreign exchange into the country and how it will affect your exchange rate. So it's a lot of tightrope walking. Now, this, therefore, when we talk of a monetary policy committee, please understand that the Monetary Policy Committee's ambit is only to lay down a rate of interest. Now, the rate of interest is one component of controlling inflation, but it's not the only component of controlling inflation. Inflation is affected by a lot of other factors. For example, if you don't have fiscal deficit, then control of the rate of inflation will have no impact, or rate of interest will have no impact on inflation. Even the rate of interest which we are talking about, what is it that a central bank does? A central bank sets the rate for its repo lending. Repo lending means if a bank has to borrow money from the central bank, it in fact sells its SLR securities and with an agreement to buy it back the next day. So it is really a one-day lending. And theoretically, repo lending is supposed to be meant for banks to only approach the central bank when they temporarily run out of funds. In practice, unfortunately, what has happened is it has become like a structural borrowing, and banks keep on rolling this. But even given this fact, and I think Mr. Kotak will confirm this, it has always been said that if the repo rates were reduced, lending rates would be reduced. But the lending rates are determined by the cost of funds to banks. And where do banks get their money? The bulk of their source of funds is bank deposits. These bank deposits, the interest rates on those bank deposits are affected by competition. But they are also affected by the rate at which the government borrows money under the small savings schemes. If, therefore, the government pays you 8.5% or 9% on a public provident fund, if the government issues tax-free bonds at 7%, then why should someone put money in a bank deposit at a much lower rate if he can get a higher rate of interest from government borrowing? So that is one big source of funding. The second is the CBLO. Now, CBLO is collateralized bank lending, which means what? It means that institutions which have funds, like the LIC or the mutual funds, they lend money to the clearing corporation, and the banks borrow money from that. So there is a large amount of borrowing from the CBLO. And then finally, there is a borrowing from the against the repos. If you look at the figures, the percentage of borrowing which banks do from repos is a small percentage of what they borrow on bank deposits and or from CBLO. Therefore, merely reducing a repo rate will not reduce the cost of borrowing to banks. It will have a strong signaling effect, but it will not necessarily have just a single effect on this one. Now, you talked about the banking and the problems with the banking sector. I think you are right about many of the reasons which you have given about why banks are in a bad shape. But we also have to recognize one fact. I think one of the problems with Indian banking is that we lend against security and not against the individual. So ultimately, it is the cash flow which is important. And banks have got into trouble because the cash flow which would generate the funds for repayment have not materialized. And one of the reasons why this has not materialized is, to some extent, beyond, for factors beyond the control of some of the borrowers. For example, the major NPAs are in respect to the power sector. But why is it that the power sector has not been functioning? The power sector has not been functioning because in some cases the gas supply is not available. So they can't generate the power. It has not been functioning because they have been selling the power to the state electricity boards, which are not paying the money for the power that they are purchasing. So it is, I think, a little unfair sometimes just to blame a big borrower if we also do not blame the policies which create conditions in which this flow did not come in. Take another example. Why are construction companies in difficulty? I know for a fact of a particular construction company, for example. It has got 4,000 crores of dues which are receivable from the state governments on contracts which it has executed, on which arbitration awards have been given in favor of the company. But merely to avoid making payment for these items, the state government goes to the court, matters are delayed and payments are not received. So I think if we have to address the problems of the banking sector, we have to also look at this situation of how do we generate the cash flows to the borrowers so that in terms they can make the payment to the banking sector. There is one other factor you mentioned about capitalization of banks. Now, this has been an issue which has been worrying people for a long time. There is no doubt that public sector banks are undercapitalized. And as you said, there is this psychological problem that government does not want to reduce its shareholding to less than 51%. It therefore does not, but it also doesn't want to put in additional funds, so capital cannot be increased. If you ask me personally, a possible solution is for public sector banks to issue non-voting shares. If they were to issue non-voting shares, they can still retain, government can still retain its 51%. But I'm sure there could be a lot of money collected from the public through a non-voting share, because a public shareholder is not really interested in voting rights if 51% is with the government. All he's interested in getting a profit. And he would balance the price at which he would be willing to subscribe, taking that factor into account. Finally, you mentioned about the problems of the Indian economy and about the growth. And I would like to just draw your attention to one factor, to all of you, in fact. Only a few days ago, Dr. Rajan gave the 13th Nani Palkhivala Memorial Lecture. And it's a lecture which, in my opinion, was really path-breaking. We are going to publish that lecture, and all of you would profit greatly if you read it when it is published. We'll be distributing this widely. But he made some fundamental points, and basically he said, we are at a situation where we are poised for growth. But he said there are four essential conditions which must be satisfied before we can achieve that growth. The first is competition, which is in a sense is really free enterprise. And he said people must have the freedom and the opportunity to start new businesses and run industries. But he also said that freedom does not mean liberty. It means that you must have limited essential controls, but the secret lies not in the fact whether you have controls or not. The secret lies in how well and how fairly you administer those controls. Because if controls are used as a mechanism to give advantages to some or disadvantages to others, then they do not serve their purpose. Second, he said patent protection. And I think this is a very, very important point. In our country, we are somewhat loose about patent protection. Therefore, it does not give enough incentive to someone to innovate if he is not very sure that he will get the benefit of the fruits of his innovation if someone else can copy it. And that is one of the reasons, perhaps, why even foreign technology has not come into the country as easily as it would have has gone into other countries. The third is, and I think it's equally important, he said, you must give individuals equal opportunity to access the facilities which you need in order for enterprise to grow. Now, that is not merely access to physical facilities. As he said, space is one of the areas where a small man may not get enough space for him to operate. He may not get the electricity. If there is a power shortage, he may not have the funds to buy a generator, whereas a big industry can do it. But more importantly is that he must have the sufficient amount of financial education, other education, to be able to compete in the business world. And that is his third factor. And the fourth one, which he said, was that you must have a system for the ordinary demise of companies. Not just that you must have an environment in which companies grow, you must have an environment in which companies are allowed to die, because it is those companies which are on a respirator, which do not die, which are taking away all the scarce resources of the company or the country and are denying those resources to those who could use them much more profitably. I think these are four points which we need to keep in mind. Having said that, I would like to thank Mr. Kotak once again for his brilliant exposition. And on behalf of the trust, I'd like to thank the Wellington Institute, Wellington Institute, for hosting this meeting today and providing the facilities. And I'd like to thank all of you for your active participation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Done? Thank you, students. Great to be here. And rest assured, picture abhi baki hai.